Welcome to Viewpoint from Overseas with your humble servant, Sabahat Ashraf, here in the seat. I Fakir, as you can follow me on Twitter and Facebook and other places. With me are our usual friends, regular friends, Faraz, Darvesh, another Darvesh sitting here in the other chair.
Yes, and I think you took my chair this time, but that's fine.
Changes are par for the course in Pakistan right now. Yeah. Misbah, Azam, Doc Saab is here to discuss things. So, friends, this has been an interesting week, internally and externally. Lots of foreign policy to talk about. And there are some interesting players. Let's start with that angle. So, we have Athar Minallah. We have Nawaz Sharif back in the game. And most interestingly, I find, Maryam Nawaz has... We have a new generation coming up.
So, here. I think this is different, right? I mean, there are so many things happening pretty much on a weekly basis. So, now Nawaz Sharif is out of the jail. There has been a lot of conspiracy theories. And conspiracy theory industry is always booming in Pakistan, maybe because of our social structure. And I love it, by the way. I love all those conspiracy theories because we can laugh at it, right? Yeah, at times, we can really laugh at it.
But here's the thing. On conspiracy theories, we have had...
And sometimes they're true, by the way.
Yes, that's what I'm going with this. So, the Pakistani conspiracy...
Because there is a history.
There is a history. Yeah.
So there are historical facts that we have only learned as conspiracy theory for decades. And suddenly they start appearing.
Okay, let me tell you an interesting story. So when I was a kid in Pakistan, we always heard a conspiracy theory that Karachi is about to become a Hong Kong. Now, I had no idea what Hong Kong looked like. I was a kid in school. But we always hoped that Karachi will turn into Hong Kong. And when I first arrived into Hong Kong and I took a tour of Hong Kong, and I was like, really... Had this conspiracy been true, we would have had a really good Karachi. I mean, Karachi would have been like Hong Kong. But anyways, not all conspiracy theories are true. But Pakistan, I guess, when I say there are a lot of Bukrat and Socrates on the streets of Karachi, you can go at any corner and you can find conspiracy theorists giving you breaking news.
Oh, no. You have to respect that.
And you have to respect that. And you can't deny it because they always have internal connections.
Yeah. So here is an interesting one, right? And let's start with Misbah Saab this time. Maryam Nawaz and Nawaz Sharif himself chose to come back to Pakistan in a situation where they knew they might go to jail, Maryam Nawaz particularly, and then went to jail for a short amount of time and came out a hero. So we have now a new... Is this a strategic move? What kind of theory do you have?
Very, very interesting word you use, a strategic move. I mean, you can see it that Mia Nawaz Sharif's career is over in the politics. All he wants his daughter to be launched because his wife wanted her to be launched there for whatever reason. But his wife was the one who brought her up. She did not want sons to be up. Maybe they are not as smart as she is or whatever. But she did that. So not only that they came back, Maryam insisted to put her in the C-class jail.
Right.
And that is a big thing, you know.
Right.
And I think...
She refused VIP protocol, basically.
She did. And now what will happen that the leaders in the parliament, you would see Bilawal Bhutto, you will see Maryam Nawaz. I don't think Shahbaz Sharif will last too long. Shahbaz Sharif's sons, I don't think they are capable.
Hamza has always been an interesting character.
This will be a Naya Pakistan 2.0.
Naya Pakistan indeed. Well, the opposition in Naya Pakistan.
So Naya Pakistan 2.0 is going to look like Bilawal Bhutto, is going to look like Maryam Nawaz. And now talking about Maryam Nawaz, see, Nawaz Sharif and Maryam, they knew they were going to go to jail. They had the choice to stay in London. Yeah. They could have stayed in London.
They could, right.
But they decided to come to Pakistan and go to jail. And they knew their mother was not going to last long. We all know that the disease, we all knew what she was suffering with. So she wasn't going to last long, but they chose to go to jail. Now, whether PTI friends like it or not, but they gave us the sacrifice. Anyhow, now I guess people of Punjab, people of Pakistan will not forget it, and I think this will go to their advantage. And in
this
the next
will come.
This will okay. come, and I think
so, we Faraz, have to see. Just to keep moving, let us throw in some more characters here. Mm. Now we have Muhammad bin Salman, and let us bring in Imran Khan Saab. They have a meeting. He goes to Saudi Arabia. And of course, this overlaps with the other story because Nawaz Sharif has always been allied with the Saudis. And they are who got him out of jail. The Saudis have an oversized influence in Pakistan, always have. Mm. But we have, you know, it's kind of a special relationship.
Right.
Despite the fact that a lot of us are not very happy with the policies and the ideology of the Saudi government. And on top of that, one thing interesting I saw is that Mr. Imran Khan went to Saudi Arabia and in one of his interviews actually said, we are very supportive of the Saudis, we will work with them closely. And from what we hear, managed to get loans and investment from Saudi Arabia. And yet made it clear that on Yemen, we will try to play a more positive and neutral role than we can. So, what do you think about that?
No, I totally agree with Imran Khan. I mean, yes, it's not just limited to Yemen. I think we need to stay away from any Saudi adventures which have to do anywhere in the Middle East, whether it's against Iran, whether it's against Yemen adventure, or whether it's a Syria adventure, because Saudis have funded ISIS. Let's just accept it. This is the reality. The Saudis have funded it. Saudis are involved in Egypt. We need to stay away from all their adventures. This is their war. This is their politics. If Mohammed bin Salman wants to go into Yemen or Syria or anywhere else to his own expense, Pakistan's, we are friends of Saudi Arabia, but we're not going to support their adventure. And this should not be applicable just to Saudis. Should be applicable to Iran. If Iran wants to do any adventure, Pakistan should stay away. It should apply to any country, whether it's even China, our closest ally.
So let me go to you, Misbah Sahib. Is this possible? Is it possible for Pakistan, who has economic challenges and is dependent on Saudi Arabia, dependent on China? How possible is it? How much of a hope do you, because we have heard the stories, the 50s, the 60s, Pakistan used to play a very important role in world politics, you know, Nixon going to China, the role, you know, relationship with Iran, the relationship with Saudi Arabia, sending troops in to defend the Hejaz. All the way up to the first Gulf War, where we heard that Pakistani troops, and the conspiracy theories again that we have heard, is that there was a point at which Pakistani and American soldiers came to blows over respect for the Hejaz. That is the conspiracy theory we have heard. So do you see us, is it possible that in this Neo-Pakistan we will be able to get to that same level of positioning for Pakistan?
Yeah, see, that is the thing that a lot of very senior intellectuals in Pakistan, public intellectuals like Adil Najam, like Ejaz Haider, like Muhid Yusuf, you know, they constantly tell that for foreign policy, they should have a think tank and think about it and then decide on the foreign policy. Okay, Saudi Arabia, the history says, and I can give you an example of a very contemporary incident in the history. Saudi Arabia plays like that. They fill your pocket first, then they demand later. They are filling your pocket, they don't demand anything. But then they say, okay, we gave you this, now you do it. So saying that by the Prime Minister of Pakistan that we are not going to get involved here and we will try to do this. You know, when Nawaz Sharif Saab came, Mr. Sharif came as a Prime Minister, what happens? They gave him $1.5 billion.
Yeah.
They didn't demand anything. And that time, the same people, which I just named you, they were asking this question.
Why?
Why? Exactly.
Why? And then later they asked for the armed forces for Yemen. Yeah.
You know.
So I think that's so
and to his credit. To his credit, let's put this on the record. It was Imran Khan Saab in opposition who was able to have that relationship. And as
see,
Azam Saab
there
is saying,
one
there is credit
thing.
For Imran Khan, there is credit for Nawaz. They were able to keep Pakistan out of Yemen as far as we know.
So there is one more thing we need to be very cautious of. We know this wave of extremism globally. Global extremism have its roots in Saudi Arabia. The fundamentalist theory of Wahhabism. They have funded Madrasat in Pakistan. So we need to be very careful. If we can we want to be close to Saudi Arabia, but we don't want that any radical ideology from anywhere coming to Pakistan.
Well, I think we'll have to keep going back to that because our Prime Minister himself has not shown too much sign, our current Prime Minister, of not being allied with the, let us say, right wing of the Muslim community in Pakistan. He's always...
Well, we need to be very careful of the clerics coming from Saudi Arabia or anywhere else, especially Saudi Arabia. We have suffered enough with the suicide bombings, Taliban support, ISIS. The problem is, we just need to be very, very careful of what funds we are getting and any funding that coming from Saudi Arabia, where is it really going? We have to be very cautious of that.
Let's wind this topic up.
Very quickly about the credit of Imran Khan did that. See, the thing is that Imran Khan was that time opposition. More than anything, Nawaz Sharif comes, he goes against
him. No, however, in this case.
The media report says that Nawaz Sharif was not interested in sending army to Saudi Arabia, but the military, the general wanted. And when general went there, he did not ask his boss that, can I go or can I go?
So there is another, let's discuss another conspiracy theory. There is another conspiracy theory that is very common in Pakistan, is that army establishment of Pakistan have got a very close alliance with Saudi Arabia, with the House of Saud. The kingdom, the monarchs, they have a very close relation with the monarch regime. And they are always having close joint operations, this deep state wars.
Yeah, but has that come back? Because the last major place, if I recall right, where the security establishment in Pakistan and Saudi Arabia fell out with each other was over the Iran-Iraq war, where the legend is that Saudi Arabia wanted Pakistan to open a second front from the other side or support the Iraqis and the quote-unquote Sunni powers, and Pakistan refused that we have a very good relationship with Iran, they're our friend.
And this was under Zia.
And this was under General Zia, who's considered a Saudi ally at least, if not worse.
Right. And you know, the interviews of General Ehsanul Haq is on the record. He was openly supporting Saudi Arabia and especially speaking against Iran. So if we have General Ehsanul Haq, who was the head of ISI, those type of generals who are open supporters of Saudi, we just have to be careful, right? I mean, we have suffered enough. Taliban policy was a wrong policy that we all in agreement with. But 5 years ago, we were not in agreement on that. But now everybody's in agreement that policy was flawed. Our soldiers were slaughtered.
The point is, we now actually have a government in Pakistan that is led by a party and a person who was always against that Taliban policy.
And Imran Khan was not against Taliban policy.
He was even doing
Imran Khan. Okay, so Imran Khan has Imran Khan has gone through transformation. Imran Khan 5 years ago was maybe a different Imran Khan. Now Imran Khan going to Pakpatan, Baba Farid, paying respect to him. So now Imran Khan is more of, looks like, apparently, on the surface at least, is a Sufi Imran Khan.
It's a Bareilvi Imran Khan,
and that Sufi Imran Khan does not go well. That Sufism does not go well with the Saudi ideology.
No, but let me clarify that. My point was not the Taliban policy supporting the Taliban. I'm saying Imran Khan was against the policy of the war on terror. He was someone that was saying, no, we need to talk to the Taliban. You know, we've all heard those stories. So he seems to be, and now he's in power.
I don't know what was the Imran Khan 5 years back, but now the Imran Khan we know today, I think is now clear on the issue of Taliban, on the issue of extremism. And I think he spoke vocally on that.
Did you see that? Do you think Imran Khan has changed his position on extremism?
Actually, the thing is that first thing, let's be realistic, okay? And what is the realism here, which we are missing, is that actually Imran Khan has nothing to do with this policy. I mean, he's not going to do anything with that, good or bad. Who is going to decide on that? Even foreign policy, saying foreign office will make policy, wouldn't do anything.
So you're saying the security establishment runs that bar?
Security establishment runs that bar. They are still doing the diplomacy. They were sitting with Chinese president, the general, and Chinese international community. See, look, I mean, recent book by Stephen Cole, if you read that book, if you are not from Pakistan, if you are not, you don't know about Pakistan, first thing comes in your mind that Pakistan runs by the military. Mm-hmm. That everything, every contact is with the military generals or intelligence officers. That's all. I mean, that's what, and it is not only one country, two country, every country.
I think
absolutely.
Let's just wrap it up. But I think it will take its course. It will take time. It will not happen overnight. Imran Khan, I think we are going through the transition towards democracy. Democracy is somewhat strengthening, and we have weighed. We can't take away powers of military establishment, policy making, in running the country overnight. It's going to take some time, and it's going to take some struggle, and I think it's going to happen slowly. And I think there is a confidence building that needs to happen between both army and the democratic forces. Now that confidence building has been lacking. We need to figure out a way, democratic institutions need to figure out a way with the army to come to an agreement that how will that policy look like.
So you're saying we need a new modus vivendi.
We need new processes, and I guess it's not going to happen overnight. It will take its course probably another decade.
Let's put a pin in that, and just to segue from there, we got a statement from the Indian Foreign Office, which actually kind of touches on this. I've had someone mention that it's interesting that statement chose to target specifically Imran Khan, to go after him as being the person whose statements and issues they were complaining about. So is this, as someone was saying, is this a matter of the Indians acknowledging, as one PTI supporter said, okay, look, they're acknowledging that Imran Khan has more control over these issues than previous governments. But on the other hand, the story goes on that they pulled out, that Imran Khan sent a tweet that, to my eye, half of it was very nice. It was the whole statement about, oh, it is unfortunate that they don't want to talk to us, yada, yada. But at the end, Imran Khan also got a little, I would say, sounded like he was still standing on a container, bad-mouthing Modi sir. Misbah sir, what's your
take? Actually, the thing is that I disagree this notion that, India doesn't know, Prime Minister doesn't know, and he said that, and he's not a smart guy and all. They all decided, and they put a trap. Imran Khan got into it.
What trap? Explain
trap that. Is very simple trap, that Imran Khan shouldn't have been saying all those thing which he said in Twitter.
You mean the nice things about India or the bad things?
No, the bad things about India. That was a wrong thing. When they got this something in their hand, they decided to go. Look at it. Let me ask you this question. Have you ever think that during the Twin Peak incident, during the Kargil incident, during the Mumbai incident, why India did not take an aggressive action against Pakistan crossing the borders and attacking inside?
Mumbai, they got a little...
They didn't do anything.
They didn't really...
Well, why?
They
didn't do anything. Tell us why.
You tell
okay. Me. The reason is that what analysts say that, they say that one reason is that India did, in Kargil especially, that if they would not take over tolling campuses, India would not do that, then they would do it. Why they did not do? Because that was their line. And why they draw the line? Because they did not want to look in the world as an aggressor. So that is the thing.
But it could be nuclear deterrence.
No. If they can do on the skirmish, they were attacked. They could.
But there is a nuclear deterrence issue. India does not want the issue to escalate.
No, that's what you and I can think of it, that nuclear deterrence. But the thing is that even if war escalated, and I agree with you, but if war will escalate, then world will say India launched the military attack like 1965 they did. This was a skirmish on the. Kashmir.
They entered from Sialkot.
They entered from here. So, if you read the book by Mr. Kuldeep Nair, that's what he say, that when Shastriji went to Tashkent, he even was kind of underdog because everybody was saying, well, you launched that.
I think what Misbah is saying is right. It could be both factors. It could be nuclear deterrence plus India wants to look, what we say in Urdu, Mazloom. They want to look at the innocent power that we are oppressed. We are oppressed. We are not the one who are attacking Pakistan. Pakistan is the one attacking us. And I think this goes back to the same discussion where I a lot of time argue with my friend that all these forces which have been declared as terrorists in UN and that whole FIFA, what is it, FIFA? FATF thing. It goes into India's advantage, India's interest that those folks are hanging out freely in Pakistan because India could always use those forces as the excuse to international community that, look, these people have been declared terrorists and they are openly hanging out in Pakistan. This goes into India's favor and not in our favor.
So we are finally getting to that strategic level I like to discuss. So you're saying this might actually be... So, but here is the thing. When on the one hand, you are saying that they're acting or thinking that strategically, while at the other hand, you have these almost juvenile statements coming back and forth from the Indian Foreign Office, from Imran Khan.
So, I'll just give you, let's do the wrap-up statement. Diplomacy, I guess, is maybe no longer in this era. President Trump in US, Prime Minister Modi in India, Imran Khan in Pakistan. Okay. Let's not expect diplomacy. These guys are straight shooters. This is a reality. They tweet. I think the course of diplomacy, the course of policy making, going through Foreign Office, going through the right channels, I guess that's not happening. And it's, I guess, maybe people have accepted it.
So this is not just a name.
You have a wrestler like person sitting in US, wrestler like person Imran Khan Macho sitting in Pakistan, and then Modi Saab, who openly says that he's a wrestler,
Pesar ki
chhati and all that. So I guess we are witnessing a different type of diplomacy.
So you're saying this is not just Nia Pakistan.
It is a collapse of traditional diplomacy.
This is Nia diplomacy.
This is a new world order, I guess.
So to wrap up, Misbah Sahab, let's come to you. What do you think of this? But before you start out, let me also say, to me, this could actually be saber-rattling. You know, just before you sit down for a negotiation, sometimes people posture. You know, whether it is Pahlwans in an Akada, or negotiation, this could just be them getting real. I mean, my one reaction I had through my head this week was stuff just got real.
Yeah, but if there's saber rattling, it worked very well because Imran Khan right away, without wasting time, tweeted that, attack personally. You know, he shouldn't be doing that. No, but the thing is that as far as India is concerned, India does not have any stakes in a peace with Pakistan, at least in a short run. So they can push things very far. Oh. Now Pakistan has to be careful, and now unfortunately the problem in Pakistan that Mr. Prime Minister is being told that you can do everything because you are better than everyone, because all those previous leaders, they were idiots, they were thieves, they were this. So he is just thinking that he has some sort of mandate, that he's just writing letters and telling the French Prime President that I'm not available. Well, you know, this is not gonna work. Okay. And that's why I gave him 1 out of 10.
Okay, 1 out of 10. So, audience, you heard us. Saber-rattling, posturing, strategic thinking, new heroes on the scene, old variables getting thrown around. Let us know what you think on our Facebook page or through our respective Twitter accounts. I am at iFakir on most of these platforms. Faraz Darvesh is Faraz Darvesh, I think.
Yep.
And Misbah Azam Saab is also available on all the platforms. And we look forward to hearing back from you and to talking to you again next time on Viewpoint from Overseas. Thank you.